Great. Forgot about that Zoom feature. So welcome everybody to this remote interview. My name is Lisette and I'm interviewing people and companies who are doing great things remotely. And today on the line, all the way from Indianapolis in the United States, in the great state of Indiana, I have Neil Miller. And Neil, super excited to talk with you. You are a fellow podcasting expert, so that's always fun to do interviews. But you are the host of the Digital Workplace Podcast, where you have now interviewed over 200 leaders about what it takes to thrive in the digital age. So we're definitely going to dive into that. You also worked with a remote team for a very long time with team members in the US and in India. Let's see. And you run the website, which is where the podcast is hosted, which is like a resource of thedigitalworkplace.com. But we're going to get into all of that. Let's start with the first question, which is, what does your virtual office look like? What do you need to get your work done?
Great question, Lisette. It's great to be here on the show and be talking with you, somebody who also thinks very deeply about this subject. So in terms of just kind of what my office looks like, I have been not at a corporate headquarters since 2016. I used to live in India for about 6 years. I was there. And then in that transition of coming back to Indianapolis, I made that transition, but continued to work with some companies there. So from that moment on, I was pretty much remote, so to speak. I used to travel there a lot, obviously, before COVID hit. But for the most part, I'm here at the house most of the time. I have a team that I work with who, a lot of them are in India, a few of them are in other parts of the world. But that's kind of the main, place that's there. So for me, that means a lot of time flexibility. I tend to work pretty early in the morning. So start my day at 5:30 just to catch people on that side of the world and work through there. But yeah, otherwise it's here at the house. I don't use a co-working space. I just kind of enjoy the little 30-second commute here and there, up and down the stairs. But otherwise, that's kind of the team setup that I'm on right now.
So the big question out there for people who love working at home, which is I'm also one of those person, I love my home office. But what do you do about like the loneliness, or do you experience that at all?
Well, today, actually, as we're recording, is the first day of school and schools are back in session. Mm-hmm. So I have 3 kids in the house right now. So for the summer, you don't really feel lonely because there's like people all around and things. And my kids are at a great age. They're not, and they're very respectful about not like jumping in, and they know the rules around that. So I don't get lonely. I have kind of a full house of folks that are around here, but I would definitely say if I was living by myself, that would be tough because I'm not naturally someone who just goes out and does stuff. I don't like to get in the car and go places. So that would be a struggle, but for me, it's not.
Right, a house full of kids, that'll solve it, that's for sure. Enough attention to go around.
Yeah.
Indeed, that's for sure. All right, so I'd love to talk about the Digital Workplace Podcast. Now, you've interviewed over 200 leaders about what it takes to thrive in the digital age. So let's start with, why did you start this podcast to begin with? And then I want to dive into like, what have you learned from the interviews? I mean, I'm sure you've learned a lot, as I have learned so much. It's like, you know, you could write a book about it, of course. Right. So, but, you know, but we're going to try to narrow it down to like some of the top things. But first, why did you start it? What was the goal there?
Yeah. So to start it, it was actually called something different. It was called Work Minus at the start. So like the first, I don't know, 60 episodes have that as a tagline. And we were trying to figure out like what did people, really progressive leaders, what were they trying to remove from work just in general to make work better? This was a project that I started with a company in India and just kept going from that. And then as the pandemic set in, we realized there's kind of a very specialty niche we wanted to fill, which was to say that we have all these digital tools in front of us now. And a lot of the tools, when you look at what we have now versus even 10 years ago, is quite advanced. Some of the technology is the same, just more improved as it's been over the last couple of decades. But definitely, like if you look at maybe 1990-ish as a starting mark of when some of these tools started to come into the workplace, they've changed the way that we work. If you look at something like email changed work. Now it got to the point where that was your work. If you went in and you spent all day clearing out emails and going through all that you were working all day. But if you ask somebody in the 1960s and they're sitting in their mailroom just shuffling through mail, they're like, you're not doing anything. Like you're just wasting time in there. So the very nature of some of these digital tools being always on, always responsive, accessible at any time, really changed things. So what we wanted to do with the digital workplace was to say, we have an opportunity here. We have all the tools we need to rebuild work in a great way and to really move out of an industrial age mindset of thinking that, hey, well, the people that I'm hiring people, they're stupid and untrustworthy. So I have to put managers in front of them and I have to monitor everything that they're doing and this and that. We have ways we want to move beyond that. So it's like saying, okay, these tools that we have can either lead us into more of that, more of the same, and keep making work bad, or we can really make something fantastic and something new and kind of the work we've always wanted for ourselves. So trying to interview leaders, often we interview the very people we're trying to connect with, CEOs of progressive companies that are trying to get off the ground and want to build a great workplace, or influencers or people who are thinking hard about this space. And are really just trying to put ideas out there. We try to say, hey, here's something you can experiment with. Here's an idea if you want to kind of move up in what it means to be a digital workplace.
Okay. So what tools do we need in order to work? What are you seeing in terms of like commonalities?
Yeah. So the question you asked earlier, like, what have I learned from it? I'm very much an arranger in my head. So every time I get an idea, I need to put it in a category or put it in a closet or on a shelf somewhere. So it took me, I don't know, maybe like 100 episodes to really kind of get a framework to what people were saying and what categories it was being put in. And overall, it kind of came down to these five areas of work that we felt like we need to take a significant look at and find ways to build up. So the first one is collaboration, which is just, you know, how we talk to each other and how we interact with each other about the work that we're doing. Another one is in culture, looking at kind of the unspoken rules of how we work, the norms, the values that we have as we go about the work that we do. Another one is leadership, how we lead each other and really how humans lead other humans, stepping back and realizing that we've kind of entered into a new world about that and need a new understanding of what that means. Another one is productivity. So moving away from productivity just being like, hey, this is hours you worked and this is therefore I'm paying you this much and that was your productivity, like recognizing that system is quite old and needs to be rebuilt there. And then the last one is technology, which is just kind of how we relate with technology. Do we always see it as something we're trying to work against, or is it something that we're always trying to use to increase what we thought was productivity, or what are some new ways we can partner and create a symbiosis with technology to create those things? So over the 200 episodes, everything we've been learning kind of usually falls into one of those categories of the nature of work and how to build that up. And honestly, like, we don't talk about a ton of tools. Like there are some like basic tools that we need out there. We need to find something that can be like the equivalent of a digital headquarters. But we don't like advocate for using a ton of digital tools out there. It's mostly about replacing some concepts in your mind and recognizing that certain things now are possible that weren't possible 20, 30 years ago.
Right, indeed. And where do you see leaders struggling the most? Is there a particular area where people, you know, it's just sort of an obvious thing? Or is it across all five areas?
Yeah, I think the struggles are different in each of the different areas. Like just take collaboration, for example. It's easy to throw a lot of collaboration tools at people. Say, okay, here's your Microsoft Teams, or here's your Zoom link, or here's your Slack, and here's like tons of stuff. And this is how we're going to talk now on digital aspects. Really with most of collaboration, we just need to get better at understanding those tools and how they work. And like take something like meetings. Like meetings were bad before the pandemic. And then when they all went on Zoom, we were very aware of how bad they were. Because if you just try to replicate what we were doing before, it just doesn't work. So in a lot of ways, it's an evolution of trying to improve the way that we have meetings, recognizing that we want to get the best use of that time. Like time, we think in a digital age, time becomes one of the most important resources you're ever going to have. So admitting, okay, if we only get this 30 minutes together, what's the best use of that time? And starting off that meeting says, okay, does anybody have an update? Is not the best use of that time, because you could have put in updates ahead of time. People could have read over those and you could have spent that 30 minutes discussing the updates instead of spending the first 20 minutes giving them. or just finding more ways to let that time be very rich when you are real time collaborating with each other. And then the other side of collaboration is just like, there's so many tools out there, having some rules about which ones your team is going to use, what you expect as a response time. There's a lot of undefinedness about collaboration and how it goes about. And so trying to help leaders and educate them about this is like what you kind of need as a bare minimum as a digital leader to work well in these platforms.
Yeah, indeed. There's a lot of unwritten norms that when we're working together in the same location, they're all visible because we can see each other and how we're working. But then as soon as people go off, you know, like who knows? Like I'm a morning person, other people are evening persons. Okay, I'm not a morning person. When I heard you get up at 5:30 a.m., I was like, oh my God, I would go right back to bed. I'd be like, oh, thank God it's still early in the middle of the night. But you know, it's like taking all that into consideration. That's one of the benefits is we all get to have our own rhythms of like what's natural for us, but then aligning on those rhythms, that's where it becomes tough. So
yeah, and honestly, like a time zone thing, like it would be tough for me to work with a West Coast company. Because I really value my evenings and those, I don't want to work then. I don't work best then. Or if I worked with a company based in Australia or Japan or something like that. So even like knowing that part about myself and giving myself the flexibility to say, like, I do well in the mornings. I'm okay getting up early. So therefore I can look at where I am and also like towards the East, UK, Europe, and even out to India. Those are times that are okay for me. Whereas somebody else who doesn't do mornings, but works fine in the evenings can look to the other side as well.
Right, right. And then really the idea is the freedom to tailor our lives, I think, is really what's driving this whole revolution. Is not that people want to work remotely, is people want the freedom to work when and where they're most productive. So we're productive. So let's talk about productivity for a while. So for yourself, what do you do in order for to like maintain good work-life balance, to not burn out, to, you know, because you're working on your own, you have a team that you're working with, but, you know, how do you keep the discipline? What are your techniques?
I think the biggest thing to look at is to define what success looks like for your team. Like, what does it mean? To me, the question of productivity is, did you do a good job today? And that can be defined in many, many different ways. So even like this week was a very abnormal week for me. My mother had a medical incident, a heart attack on Sunday, which she's never had before. And so it's kind of like a big thing. And so like, I wanted to go down there and be with her. And so I was there, but I was still like doing a little bit of work, but not that much from Monday to Wednesday. And then I drove back home to where I am now for the last couple of days. And can I say that this was still a good week? If I look back on everything we accomplished, like, yeah, actually, like, even though my hours were much less than they were before, I was still able to move forward in a lot of the things that I wanted to do because I defined those big level objectives that are out there. So whether that be reaching a certain number of people or having a certain number of one-on-one conversations, just keeping that big picture in mind and removing that pressure on myself to say, hey, if I didn't put in 40 hours this week, it was a bad week. Like we have to be able to break out of that and say, what was it that you were actually wanting to do with those 40 hours? And did you accomplish that in 20? And that's fine if you did. So that's one thing, is just to take away that pressure that says that time equals work. We should be measuring time just for our own benefit, for our own wellness, to understand like what it takes. But to say that I had a good week because I put in so many hours. I think that that's something I want to break away from. So that's like the big productivity picture that's out there. Moving away from that, it's a lot of prioritization, I would say, which kind of fits into that. Like I can spend my whole day like doing stuff that doesn't matter, but trying to focus in and saying, look, I only have so much time. I don't like working a lot. Like I don't mind saying like, I don't try to wear that as a badge of saying like I put in so many hours. Like I like having weeks where I'm not really clocking in very much time. But if I'm going to have that lifestyle and still be successful, then I need to make sure that the time I do work is very focused. And like I'm focused on those big things. And there's a lot of things I just never get done because they're so low on the priority list. And that's fine because I've made that decision too.
Andy, there is really a different culture. When I moved to Europe, I discovered that, you know, in the US, there is a culture of like, you just work as hard as you can and the more hours, the better. And there's sort of this really driving work ethic in the US. And in Europe, when you work so much without a break, they think that it's bad time management. It's really frowned upon, that sort of whole attitude. I think it's so deeply rooted in my American roots. So, but like those kind of, indeed, like that time is an old mindset. It's really all about results and value now. And that's a really hard shift, I think, for anybody to make.
It's extremely hard. And it's like getting rid of an addiction or a drug that you're used to, like to assume that, like, yeah, it's 2 o'clock and I've done all the big stuff I need to do. And I recognize my own energy management and I'm not going to start something new at 2:30 and be done with it by 4. Like, that's ridiculous. So I'm going to be better off just leaving or stopping work, whatever that means for you, and carrying on from then. And I think that, yeah, it's a cultural thing, like you said, too. There are certain cultures that really push that from a national standpoint, but also from one company to another. Like, it's all about the grind and the hustle and getting that out there. Or is it about, hey, like, I got what needed to be done. Like, we all want to live good lives. So, yeah, enjoy.
Yeah, now it's time to play.
Yeah,
I've really enjoyed like Cal Newport's advice in his book, Deep Work. He says we should be on and off. So like when you're on, be on. And then when you're off, like be off. It's also good and healthy. And I think a lot of us after the pandemic have learned or are trying to learn how to be off.
Yeah, that's a big struggle. And to know, especially when like you're off and you're on are using the same screen or using the same location or the same people around you as they always were. Like, it's hard to make that switch in your mind. Between things. So I always try to like have some kind of transition moment in the day when it's like, okay, now I'm done working. And so this is there. And this is what actually like kids in school, just for me in my situation, is actually a good thing for that. Because when they come home, then that's a clear sign. It's like, okay, like work's done for the day. So if I got to get it done, I got to get it done before they're there. I've also done like trying to take up like a piano or a musical instrument and just spending 20 minutes, 30 minutes playing that. And that's like the signal to myself that, hey, this time is transitioned from work time to play time or enjoy time.
Indeed. I've been speaking with a lot of people who have said that during the pandemic, they've picked up a non-screen related hobby just because it was so intense. Like we'd get off work off from our screens and then we'd watch Netflix and YouTube and social media. And, you know, at a certain point you've reached the end of the internet and your eyeballs are, you know, can also feel it. So yeah. So I love that people have picked up all kinds of hobbies. I also did. It was fun. So We're this is going fast. We're starting to near the end of the time, but I really want to dive into two particular things. And let's talk about the culture aspect first, because it kind of goes into alignment and productivity. And then I want to talk about the 5 levels of a digital workplace, because we can't go without, it's a brilliant categorization, but I think it's also where we're headed, right? Like people are making the shift to the digital workplace and there are different levels of maturity. Matt Mullenweg has talked about this. Buffer has all kinds of, you know, scales. There's all kinds of things out there. Let's talk about culture, just because since you have that firsthand experience of actually living in another country for a long period of time, you can really speak to sort of understanding each other's cultures. And I guess maybe my question would be, what advice would you give to teams that are working on a multicultural team, whether it be different countries or just other aspects of culture? You know, there's like man versus woman, there's cat people versus dog people. It's not always country-based. What advice can you give for helping each other understand each other's cultures? How do we even know what we don't know?
Yeah, that's tough. Obviously, in my situation, like living in a completely foreign place like India for 6 years, like one that forced me to be pretty humble in things. I saw other people who were expats who came in and kind of expected a team to operate like an American team. And obviously, that's not going to go well. So starting off with that stance of humility of saying like, I'm a foreigner here. I was a privileged minority, but a minority there. So it was easier for me to assume, okay, whatever you guys are doing, I will adapt myself to. Now, if you're in a situation where you're multicultural, you have lots of different things there. You have one person from all sorts of different places. Then you still need that attitude of humbleness and not assume that everything you're bringing to the table is the best. And whatever your norms are the best, but letting other people just recognizing that there are differences, and that there are good things about those differences. I remember when I was doing I used to do cultural training, communication training for people coming in and out. And I was amazed by just how much bias and to some extent, just racism is there in that cultural training. because it was almost like trying to explain, these sad people from India, that they're so indirect and they don't know how to work properly like the rest of us. So here's some excuses for why that's there. Like, that was how it was presented.
Oh God.
But then, like, while I was in the middle of it, realizing, oh, this is actually quite a nice way to communicate, or I understand the nuances behind this, and looking back on my own culture and realizing, oh, there's some things I don't like about that. So a lot of it just comes down to humility and being willing to recognize that somebody else out there is probably doing something. And there's a reason they do it. Like, that was, even trying new food was always like, hey, somebody really likes this food. Like, it doesn't look appetizing to me right now, but somebody, this is their favorite food out there. Like, I wonder why. And just approaching things from that aspect.
I love it. So a big dose of humility and curiosity.
Yeah, definitely.
Of like trying to withhold the judgment of being different, because it's always, I mean, it's immediate, right? We see people on the street, they're different, and all, it's like a, you know, it's like we're like the Muppets in a way, like criticizing the, you know, criticizing from the sidelines. It's
very
easy to do. Yeah, indeed. So I love that. Okay, but we have to talk about the five levels of a digital workplace. So first, why did you develop these different levels? What was the inspiration for doing that? And then if you can, we'll go through like what, you know, I know we don't want to take up, you know, like 30 minutes of all the different workplaces. It won't be a lecture or anything, but maybe we can summarize sort of the different levels and why they're important.
Well, yeah. And you and I were even talking before about stealing thoughts and adapting thoughts. And I call myself a thought stealer, not a thought leader, just because I take things from other people. I got this insight because I was trying to wrestle with this idea of like how to progress in digital workplaces. And I heard a podcast with Matt Mullenweg from Automattic. And he was talking about these different levels of remote working. And there was just something about it that just brought so much clarity and so much, just released all the ambiguity about what was supposed to happen. And so mine's totally like shamelessly built on some of the ideas that he put out from that. So the
that
idea
was
is
the
that,
interview with Sam Harris, I'm assuming.
Yeah, Sam Harris,
yeah, that was an eye opener for me. I've listened to it like 5 or 6 times. I became a huge Sam Harris fan after that as well. So yeah, amazing interview of people. I'll list it in the show notes.
Yeah, please do. So the concept I wanted to draw from it was to give people a little bit of a roadmap to say, okay, becoming a digital workplace is not like, hey, we all went to Zoom and Slack, therefore we're digital. Like this is a journey. This is something that's going to take us some time to figure out and how to get to. But there tends to be like different, paths that people take along that way. So we just say like level one is where you're fully in the office, or the office is your headquarters. Maybe a few times people are out or different things, but everything's pretty well physically based, and that's your headquarters that's there. A level two digital workplace means you are trying to replicate whatever you did in the office. You're trying to find the digital replication of that. So if you had meetings all day in the office, because you're able to do that, then you just have Zoom meetings all day. The way you built culture in the office, you're trying to build the culture through like these digital happy hour type things, because we did happy hours before. So it's always this kind of one-to-one correspondence. And in general, that doesn't last very long, because people get tired of that. People get tired of being on the Zoom meetings all the time. People get tired of checking their phone all the time for Slack messages. It's not really a sustainable place to stay. And that's where you're going to find a lot of struggle. And as people enter into this new world of hybrid work, where they're trying to have all that together, it's going to be a struggle for a long time. And a lot of people aren't going to like the world they live in. So then we try to move to what we call level three, which is really seeing like, what are the native advantages of digital work? And some things you couldn't get in the office that you can get with digital places. So for the example, just like the lack of commute is a great advantage that's not something you're trying to replicate. It's just something new and something different. Or looking at meetings again, like the fact that we can do closed captioning. So somebody who's a non-native speaker of English perhaps is able to follow along maybe a little bit better because of that. Or we can record this meeting. We can share it with somebody else. Like, these are things we maybe could have done, but couldn't do very well in an office environment. So you're starting to see some of those new advantages. And level four is where we talk about, this is where we're really starting to do the work of rebuilding from the ground up a lot of these core concepts. We try to use the values of things we've talked about before, things about the value of time. Like if we really value time as the most important part of people's lives, like how would we structure this meeting? How would we structure this offsite? How would we structure this team kickoff thing? Having respect for humans, recognizing that we want to be human first, human centric, as we're doing work. recognizing the value of intentionality. We often say like digital workplaces take a lot of work, and they're like building or working a garden. Like if you don't plant it, if you don't water it, if you don't weed it, it's not going to grow. As opposed to some in-office models are more like forests. They're like, it's probably going to grow and it's probably going to be fine even if you don't touch it. But digital work takes a lot more intentionality. And then another thing you've talked about is just agency, letting people have the choice. Like you can have choices that you didn't have before. So it's taking all those five concepts of like the collaboration, the culture, the productivity, the technology, the leadership, and saying, what would it look like if we rebuilt this and did something new? That's where the fun work and the exciting work happens. And then level five is just like that experimentation phase. You have a comfortability, you have like a foundation of everyone's feeling good about where you are. And you have the capital, so to speak, to run some experiments to say, hey, let's try a 4-day work week. Let's see what happens. Or let's try to, you know, maybe we do want to meet together once a year in this place, or we want to meet together once a week in this place, or we want to try something very new about compensation. Or we want to try something very new about how we judge productivity. Like you have the space to make those experiments because you've built up the trust throughout the levels and you kind of have that comfort. So that's a brief view of those five levels that are out there that we have.
Indeed. And where do you see most people going wrong in terms of trying to get to the different levels?
Mostly just like mainstream is that we're going to get stuck in that level two. And specifically like when it comes to things like culture, like I think the productivity discussion is actually moving in a good direction. I would not say like everyone's there, but you're starting to see more people talk about results. It's not just about hours. Like that's good. When it comes to culture, I think leaders are really struggling to figure out what that is because you can't replicate what was there in the office in a digital format. It just won't happen. Right. You have to do something totally different and totally new. And we're also still in this pandemic where it's very difficult to get people together in the same place, even if you wanted to. I think that's an important part, is that a digital workplace doesn't mean fully remote all the time. You never see each other. Usually you have these opportunities monthly, semi-annually, annually to get together. And we just haven't had that. So I think most people are really struggling with that and what that looks like. And if you have managers and leaders who are used to having control, used to being a little bit more micromanaging, used to measuring productivity by, do I see people working? They're going to struggle with all of this and finding those kind of replications, and will often want to pull back. And so I think you are going to see a lot of companies that just double down on kind of that old style of work as soon as they can. And I'm all for like in-person offices. That's great. Like if that's your thing and you want to be together all the time, great, fantastic. And if people aren't looking for that kind of flexibility that they have other places. But it's just more that industrial age thinking that we need to move away from, and that idea about productivity, especially.
Yeah, it seems like offices were just going to become another location. Like when I was interviewing Darren Murph from GitLab, and he was saying that, you know, we're trying to move to this remote first model where we're not remote. And in fact, we should recall it, we're distributed. Everybody's distributed. Some people are distributed in the office. Some people are at home. Some people are traveling. Some people are co-working spaces. It's just, you know, it's just another location that we go to. And that seems to be eventually where we're going to be headed. It's just, I can't see people going back to full-time 9-to-5. Like cats out of the bag.
Yeah. And like you said, there's two axes there. There's the time, the 9-to-5 thing, and then there's the place too. Because some people want that flexibility of, I don't want to have to go to the office, but they still want to work all at the same time. And different people are in that leadership role need to make sure they're making that distinction too. When they say, hey, we're doing hybrid, are you still expecting people to be logged on at the same time, no matter where they are? Or are you also giving that flexibility of time? Or maybe it's flexibility of space, like you can work wherever you want, and whatever time you want. So there's like different ways to look at that. That's really an important thing. And like you said, I think offices will become features of companies. Like it used to be like the office was the headquarters, that's where everything was. Now it's like a feature you can add on. Like, hey, we can use this space when we want to for these specific reasons that are good, but it's just like a thing that we also have. Oh, by the way, we have an office that we can use.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, there's a collaboration space where we could have a huge brainstorming session if we wanted to, or we could have a party there on Thursday nights, or So, and I think, you know, people are adults, and it's not like they're going to avoid the office, right? Like, we're adult professionals. So if we need to come in because our team needs us there, I can't imagine anybody saying, I'm still not coming in. Like, that's not the team player that you want on your team, right? Like, if the team needs you there, you want to be there. That's a high performing team.
Right? Yeah, I know. I love that adult things, because like, one, we need to recognize that, like, we are functioning adults. We make decisions in our life. Like, you choose to buy a house, you choose to buy a car. You don't ask anyone's permission and get it approved and everything like that. Like, you can make high functioning decisions on your own. Most of society does that. But when you're in a situation where you're kind of conditioned to act like a child and always ask permission and always try to find ways around things, then you might act like that too. So we need to treat each other like adults. And we also, I think in general, like, we can all level up the way we work and be more responsible and adult in those things too.
Yeah, there's pros and cons to every situation, but I think that the amount of freedom that we get in return for having adult behavior is well worth the shift. Absolutely. Well worth the shift there. But okay, I'm preaching to the choir here, I think, everybody on this podcast. Okay, so a couple of just very last questions. I've already gone over time. I just had so many notes, I couldn't help it. But, so very last questions, though, which would be, if people wanted to, advice for people who are really struggling, let's narrow it down to, they're struggling with productivity. Let's bring it back down to productivity. What's one tip that you would give from your own experience?
Like their own personal productivity that's there?
Yeah. Like, you're struggling with like, oh, I've got a whole day, I'm all by myself. How do I organize myself so that I'm still getting stuff done and not burning out? Like, where would you advise people to start?
Yeah. And I think that goes back to that adult question. Like, who is trained for that? Who like finished college and is like, I know exactly how I need to structure my day to get things done. Like, no one. So building those skills, like, for me, productivity comes down to task management. Like, don't just assume that because somebody said it, it's going to stay in your head. Like, you need to write it down somewhere and put it in some other system, whether it be physical or digital. Like, you need to have some other system for your task management. Second is prioritize. You need to find a way to take all those tasks and reorder them based on what needs to be done first. Like, that's huge. If you can do that, then you're in a really great place. Third is like your whole time management, about looking at how much time you actually have. Don't assume that you can get a lot done. Assume that you're only going to be able to get maybe the first three or four things on your list done. And structure it around your energy too. Like, try to find, say, I work really well in the mornings or in the evenings, or I need a long break in the middle of the day, or I like to work straight through. Like, experiment and find that out about yourself. And the last part is focus. No matter if you have the time, you know exactly what you need to do, there's always going to be some kind of distracting thought that comes in. And even when you're by yourself at your home, like, we always like to blame things on a coworker or somebody else that's coming and pinging us. But man, it happened to me all the time. Like, I'm just sitting there and a thought comes in my head and I'm like, oh, then I'm off on videos for a while. So finding ways to train yourself to bring that focus back is tough, but there's a lot of good tips out there.
Yeah, there's a lot of cats on the internet.
There are a lot.
Sure. All right. So, very last question, which is, if people want to learn more about you and what you're working on, or listen to the Digital Workplace podcast, what's the best place that they can go?
Yeah, it's thedigitalworkplace.com. I would recommend, maybe if you're just kind of experimenting with these ideas, there's a score that we have, a quiz you can take to kind of figure out what level you're at right now. Both maybe in your team or in your bigger organization as well, that can give you a sense of where you need to move forward and go forward with that. We're on LinkedIn and Twitter, same thing, The Digital Workplace, and we'd love to connect and learn more about where people are.
Awesome. And I'll include all of that in the show notes. Neil, thank you so much for your time and your wisdom today. I've really enjoyed this conversation.
Me as well. Thanks so much, Lizette.
All right. Until next time, everybody, be powerful.